Welcome, Chetna. It is wonderful to have an official interview sitting with you. It's my honor. Welcome to this conversation.
My pleasure, Lakma.
How did you zero in on microfinance in particular and then the two institutions would be very interesting because it was a way ahead of its time idea. Microfinance in itself was a way ahead of its time, but for women and those who were probably not at all empowered even through literacy was unheard of and what it has become today. So that will be very good to know for you.
Many women headed families, they would like to save. So many women came to me and they said, we want to do savings. And I was like, you know, if you want to do savings, then we should go to the banks to open the saving account. And that was the reason why they were coming, that we are saving in dabbas and all that. So that time nobody was talking about microcredit, but women wanted to do savings, so went to the banks. Banks said that, you know, they are not affordable client. Kantabai, street vendor, having a business of blacksmith, she was insistent, yeah, I want to save money and buy a tarpaulin sheet because I'm staying with my family on the street. And there were so many such women who wanted to plan their lives and save the money.
Yeah.
We went to the banks. Banks said that their amount is too small for us to open the account. So women said, what should we do now? And I said, if they are not opening, why not start the bank?
Anyone else would have said that banks are not opening, so at least let's save in your own homes. Finally, it's 2 rupees, 20 rupees. For, I think one is remarkable that these women attempted to go to the bank instead of putting it in their, you know, how generally homemakers are trained to hide it in boxes and in rice bags and everything. Instead of that, wanting to access a bank, that in itself shows the aspiration far beyond their current reach. 62% of the women that we saw through the landscape study found that arranging finance was the single largest challenge that is faced by them. Abhi, when you're looking at, you know, your 25 years with Mandeshi, what do you think are some of the key structural societal barriers that restrict women? And how does government play a very key role in removing those restrictions?
So when we talk about the barriers, I find like one very across sector, one barrier which we clearly see is that the whole ecosystem is not only supporting women, but it's against women, right? In the sense that no property, in your own, no ownership of property, no assets, no collateral, and no, there's no motivation, or I would say like in family, if boy is there, everybody would say that, okay, you know, we would invest, paisa denge, business shuru karo. But if daughter, they would say ki nahin, nahin, you better you get married, and agar karna jo hai, wo after marriage. Even your parents say that. And then
yes,
we will say that, see, if you are doing business, if there is a losses, you are responsible for that. So this is a barrier. Now in this barrier, how would policymakers intervene to actually address this? Because women are trying their best, right? When you see the reports, I would like to quote that World Economic Forum in 2018 did the study that it closed the gender gap. How many years it will take? It will take around 135 years to close the gender gap globally.
From the date we decide to close it.
Yeah, right. Gender component has to be seen at every level, from the policymakers to the sector on the supply side. And on the demand side, they are ready. I find that wherever that these obstacles are there, women actually come with the solutions.
Yes.
Open are we to take these solutions?
Now that COVID has happened and we have completely blindsided by everything else except the digital access, there is a very different kind of danger to this whole concept of women entrepreneurship. So many micro businesses have had to either shut down or have been running in losses. How do we bring in financial literacy or any other tool to now in this current narrative enable women entrepreneurs?
when the pandemic happened and we saw that in Masward, there were many ATMs, but we saw the traffic of ATM in Mandeshi was more. Now, one will be happy, but we just were trying to understand what was the reason. And we did a survey and we found out that in Mandeshi's ATM, the people, those who were withdrawing, gender agnostic, they were saying that we could get 100 rupees note instead of 500 rupees note, right? Now it is actually, it's very small thing, but people said that if we withdraw and if we only get 500, our need is 100, then we will spend the remaining 400 without planning.
Yeah.
So here, that was a learning for us that actually people are talking about planning and we are pushing our ideas without planning. That taught us that, you know, you talk about digital, you talk about cashless, but the nature of going digital will be very different.
Scaling of businesses, access to working capital is another barrier altogether. So even if you are, you can be a small woman business entrepreneur, you can manage it too. But scaling becomes almost again a next big, big barrier because access to working capital is not available, even if you have proved that you are viable and financially a solid proposition. Okay, what do you see that can be done around it? Or are we very, very behind on that in terms of recognizing that there's a significant cadre of women ready for the next step who will not get their working capital access?
There are 2-3 areas I would like to touch on of the scaling of business, particularly after COVID, what we experienced. One thing was that, you know, when these women were making masks or giving catering food dabbas at the home, and they said that today we are making, say, in the hospitals they were providing, and they said today we are making 200 chapatis a day. We want to make 500 chapatis.
Correct.
How do we do? And immediately we said, okay, we will design a product which gives a hypothecation loan for women to buy machinery. Scaling of business will come with machinery. So we started this hypothecation for loan for machinery. And you'll be surprised that during COVID, more than 1500 women have bought the machinery and have scaled it. What I'm trying to say is that if this way, it becomes easier for women to scale the business. And once they scale, right, then that digital buying and selling of the raw material comes, where their digital transaction becomes visible. My transaction goes digitally, and then I have a digital repository of not only my product, my transaction also, and that gives the risk sharing on the supply side, those who are giving access to capital.
It's always been wonderful talking to you, Chetna. In a world that was largely designed by men for men, if we are even trying to make women inclusive policies or women inclusive products or products that consider what a woman requires, it is not impossible. It is not difficult. It basically needs good intent and purposeful listening to craft things that are very simple to execute.